After completing this unit, you would be able to describe survey method in your own words, explain the different types of survey methods, select appropriate method according to the research question, list out the sequential steps to carry out survey research, and describe the advantages and limitations of survey research. You must have come across till now about different types of researches, particularly based on the analysis of the data. They are classified, as you know, as qualitative and quantitative type of researches. The quantitative researches, where the analysis is done quantitatively, again there are various methods of conducting that research. You have come across the experimental researches as well as the non-experimental researches. In those non-experimental researches, the very first, which is very convenient to adopt in a research paradigm, is the survey research. Today, we will be knowing more about survey research. Uma, the principal of Balika Vidyalaya, wanted to find out how her teachers are spending their teaching time in primary classes. What should she do about it? She prepared a questionnaire and included in that various teaching strategies such as discussion, demonstration, drama, play, storytelling, involving students, asking questions and answers, and so on. After that, she selected 10 teachers out of the 40 teachers and gave that questionnaire for them to fill in. Once she got the filled in questionnaires, she analyzed the questionnaire answers and then reported the findings. This whole approach, what she has done, is termed as survey research. If we look at the historical perspective of survey research, we find its roots in the Britain in the Victorian region. At that time, the social reformers wanted to find out about poverty and life of working class. For that, they use the survey. After that, it is widely used in applied social research. The word survey comes from the Latin word sur, which means over, and to vide, that means to see. Therefore, it is to see over. It eventually means a general or comprehensive view of anything. The survey research means collecting data to answer questions, to test hypotheses, and find opinion of people about some topics of issue. It is an attempt to collect data from members of the population by asking small group, which is the sample, and using that to find out about the whole population. The data is gathered to find out some characteristics of the population. It often focuses on a particular variable or factor. It also may operate on the basis of hypotheses, which is generated from the earlier qualitative research. It aims to gather data without manipulation of any kind, and it deals with naturally occurring phenomena, which is non-intrusive. It is an important type of tool or method and not just clerical gathering of information. It involves a clearly definite problem and definite objectives. It requires meticulous and imaginative planning, careful consideration and interpretation of the collected data, and final reporting systematically the findings. Survey research is normally used to learn about people's attitudes, beliefs, habits, their desires, their behaviors, and so on. It describes the incidence frequency. It also describes the characteristics of an identified population. The data collection procedures are very, very explicit. They focus on individual subjects and go into greater depth for defining them. Survey research investigates large group of subjects. These are often the predetermined classes, and the analytical procedures tend to show results that are average behavior of the group. Whitney defines survey research as an organized attempt to analyze, interpret, and report the present status of social institution, group, or area. While Herman defines the survey as a brief method of analysis in scientific and orderly form for a defined purpose of given social institution or situation of problem or population. Thus, survey provides a snapshot of how things are at a particular time. Let us now come to the types of survey research. On the basis of involvement of the subjects, surveys can be classified into two types, the sample survey and the census survey. The sample survey considers a small group from the whole population, while the census survey includes all the members of the population. Consider these research questions. What is the average length of time teachers use to prepare lessons? Describe the scientific attitude of standard 4th students. What are the most popular techniques used by high school counselors? What do principals think about inclusive education? If you look at these research questions, you will find that they are asking for some description. Therefore, these surveys are known as descriptive surveys. If you look at these questions, do teachers who are temporary more innovative than those who are permanent? Is there a relationship between teachers' attitude towards discipline and student satisfaction? Do teachers who blame colleagues have more conflicts than those who blame themselves? Now, these questions are asking for not having any idea or information, and therefore they are asking for exploration. Therefore, when these type of research questions are there, we call them exploratory surveys. Now look at these questions. Why do some principals organize regular parent-teacher meetings and others do not? What is the reason some integrated schools are truly integrated while others remain segregated? Why are students in some schools achieving better than similar students in another school? Now, if you look at these research questions, you will observe that these are asking for some type of reason. That means they are asking for explanation. And therefore, these surveys or these researches are termed as explanatory surveys. So, on the basis of research question, we have identified three types of surveys: the descriptive survey, the exploratory survey, and the explanatory survey. One such type of explanatory survey is also termed as ex post facto or causal comparative. In this type of research, causal comparative or ex post facto, the independent variable has already occurred and the researcher observes the dependent variable. It is different than the experimental research in a way that there is no manipulating of the independent variable. Here, since the baseline data is not available, the researcher only observes the cause after the effect has taken place. Another way of identifying or classifying survey research is depending on the procedure. There are two types of survey research in this aspect. One is considered as cross-sectional and the other as longitudinal. The cross-sectional survey research is observing subjects at a particular time from the population, while a longitudinal survey research observes the subjects on a span of time, so it takes a longer time. Let us see more description about these two types of researches. Let us first consider the cross-sectional research. It is used to examine current attitudes or behaviors or opinion of the subjects. It can also be used to compare two groups at a particular time. It can also be used to measure the community needs of educational practices. It can be used to assess students or teachers of a particular program, as well as it can be used to evaluate a particular program. In a cross-sectional research, the respondents are questioned about a particular time once. If the interviews are conducted by computer-assisted telephonic interview form, then also the surveys can be termed as important. They only cover one topic at a time. When face-to-face mode is selected for survey, then many topics can be taken up at a particular time, as against the computer-assisted telephonic inventory. The advantages of cross-sectional design is that it is low cost and it considers many respondents at a single time. And therefore, we find that it is the most useful method in conducting survey. And most of the researches follow this particular method. The other method of survey is a longitudinal survey. In this method, again, there are three types. One is known as trend, the other is cohort, and the last is panel. In a trend survey, a trend is looked at over a period of time. It's like, what was the thing at 2011, then 12, then 13. So looking at, suppose, the admissions in a particular college, what is the trend of admissions at various years? Cohort means a small group of a population which has similar characteristics. So in a cohort survey, a small selected group which has cohesive nature is selected and studied over a period of time. A panel study is where the researcher studies the same group of people over a period of time, like how were the people at a particular year in, suppose, 2010, and then their characteristics are again studied after some years, say 2015, and so on. Let us see each of these types in detail. Unlike the other two types of longitudinal survey, trend survey is not depending on the same sample. It is selecting a different group at different times in the timeline. And then a particular trait or factor or a variable is studied for that particular group over a period of time. Since it doesn't have to get the same people again and again, the cost of trend survey is comparatively lower than the cost of panel surveys. In the panel survey, the selected respondents are surveyed at least twice, or maybe more than that. A clearly defined time has to be elapsed between the two interviews or two processes of data collection. Since the respondents are required to be selected for data collection over a period of time, their addresses are kept with the researcher and the respondents have to agree to that. However, their anonymity is kept confidential by the researcher. Online surveys are more useful for panel design. In a panel survey, therefore, it can be clearly identified that who has changed the opinion over a period of time and who has not. The Delphi design is just like a panel design. The only difference is it is in the second round As opposed to the panel design, in a Delphi design, the results of the first round of collection of data is given to the participants in the second round. And the participants have to comment on this data in the second round. And therefore, there is a possibility of making it more clear and precise. Naturally, the Delphi design is not to establish facts, but to find out the opinions. This particular approach is more suitable for finding out the trends in a survey type of research, where the participants can look at their original opinions and change them over a period of time. The cost of Delphi is little higher than the other types of research in survey. Therefore, it is normally used only when the trends are to be identified with a small group of respondents. The other advantage is that the other members of the group are not known to the respondent. So, it is the individual respondent who is responding, and the researcher then analyzes the results, supply them again to the respondents without knowing the other respondents. Since in a Delphi research, the other participants are not known to the respondent, the small group procedures can be ruled out as explanation.